You are listening to the Roberta Glass True Crime Report, putting the true back in true crime. From New York City, Roberta Glass is now on the record.
Hello, happy Sunday. I hope everybody is doing well. It is a beautiful day in New York City. And I wanted to talk really quickly about Making a Murderer and Stephen Avery and Brendan Dassey, Teresa Halbach's killers today, because I think it still matters. And For one, we have the Convicting a Murderer documentary coming out with Candace Owens as host on the Daily Wire this summer. It doesn't have a date yet, but it is coming out. And that, is, of course, is the answer to Making a Murderer, the wildly inaccurate portrayal of Stephen Avery and Brendan Dassey's conviction for the murder of Teresa Halbach. And that documentary was just outrageous in what it did. It edited footage of courtroom testimony to make it look like law enforcement officers were saying things that they weren't saying. The filmmakers embedded themselves in the Avery family and made an advocacy piece for him that is not to be believed. And after it came out, the prosecutor, the former prosecutor, Ken Kratz, did a one-man PR campaign to get the truth out about all the evidence, or the really important evidence would be a better way to put it, that convicted Stephen Avery and Brendan Dassey. And did the country thank him for that? Did they welcome him with open arms and say, thank you so much, I was fooled by this documentary? Because when it came out, it created such a sensation. Everybody was talking about it. And I don't know about you, but when I saw the scene where Stephen Avery kills a cat, and I'm not going to go into detail, but in a really cruel way, burns it alive. And that's me not going into detail, because the detail is so much more disturbing. That's when I was out. I said, you know, this guy may be innocent, but I cannot be a part of this. Once you torture and kill an animal, then I'm not interested in being your advocate. I don't care how much prison time you're doing. That's just my point of view on it. And I've spoken with other people who've had the same point of view, that just that scene alone was just too repellent for them to continue on watching the documentary. So I'm going to just take a quick little break, rest my voice, and I have a couple clips to show you. But in the meantime, I'll meet you back on the other side of the break. If you are enjoying this episode of my True Crime Report, please hit the thumbs up, subscribe to the channel, and share this episode. Get access to exclusive podcasts and other bonus content by becoming a patron today. If you have a question or comment for me, shoot me a super chat, and I'll do my best to answer it and read it on air. Thanks so much. Now back to the show. So I think that Making a Murderer is a extremely important piece of media, if you are interested in learning what the innocence fraud phenomenon is all about. And I think it was perfectly encapsulated by journalists and now retired police officer. Congratulations, Martin Frye, on your retirement. When he said about innocence fraud and what the media does, he says they turn the cops into criminals and the criminals into folk heroes. And it was so good at what I think innocence fraud is all about, is taking something that is untrue and making it seem true, feel true, and really getting people to advocate for some of our most dangerous and deranged killers. Tomorrow, this is a movement, the Free Stephen Avery and Free Brendan Dassey movement, that intersects with so many movements. For one, the teen killer movement, and two, which is the movement to end life without parole for juveniles, which is if you get life without parole as a juvenile, what you have done is so heinous. So what I mean is that your age is such a mitigating factor that to get life without parole, your crime has to be really extreme in how offensive and really immoral and crazy over the top it is. So if you learn nothing from this episode and just that, but that movement is a $1 billion movement. So Brendan Dassey was a teen when he helped his uncle Stephen Avery kill Teresa Halbach and essay her. And many people, of course, the strongest evidence against Brendan Dassey is the confession. So, of course, it's going to be a false confession. And the strongest evidence against Stephen Avery, I believe, is the forensic, the DNA evidence. And so, of course, they're going to say it's planted and it was all a big plot. It's all a conspiracy. The conspiratorial mind is really key to understanding this movement. So I wanted to first look at an interview with Ken Kratz, a recent one, about convicting a murderer. And we get to see him in today. It's like been so long, right? I feel like since we've seen Ken Kratz do these kind of interviews, because after the documentary, he was everywhere. And I'll never forget being in NXIVM hearing and talking to one of the journalists. And she said, we were talking about Ken Kratz. And she said, you know, he contacts me all the time to just get another story out. So he was relentless, and good for him, because I believe it really worked. Now, what's left of that movement is really the true believers, the people who are absolutely convinced. It does. I believe that no amount of evidence against that you could tell them against Stephen Avery would convince them. I think they are absolutely connected emotionally to that movement, to Free Avery. And I don't think anything you'd say could convince them. So here it is.
Editor of the Wisconsin Law Journal. We're here in Fond du Lac, Wisconsin today with former district attorney for Calumet County, Ken Kratz. Hi, Ken. Got a few questions for you.
Hi, Steve. Glad to help.
Tell me, who killed Teresa Halbach?
Stephen Avery and Brendan Dassey.
And if we were to assume for a moment that Mr. Avery did not kill Teresa Halbach, who would you put as the...
Not for nothing, but how many interviews have you seen with Ken Kratz where he's standing up alone like this up against a white wall? It's such an odd thing, isn't it? It seems like you'd expect him to be on like a police lineup or something with this, wouldn't you? It's odd, right? Interesting. And what this film, I don't know, I'll call it a documentary. Mockumentary is more like it. what it did to Ken Kratz was made him the absolutely in fear of these Stephen Avery and Brendan Dassey supporters, because a lot of them have criminal backgrounds themselves or criminals in their family, and they are extremely aggressive and extremely angry at anyone who disagrees with them.
First suspect.
Nobody.
To the best of your knowledge, do you believe that Manitowoc County law enforcement or any other law enforcement entity planted evidence in this case?
Not in this case. And I don't know of any other case.
Ken, if you had been on the other...
Not in this case. Not in this case. And I've actually never seen it happen in this county. Despite the documentarians, the New Yorkers who came in, I don't know if they were New Yorkers. They went to Columbia. Columbia grad students, weren't they? Laura Riccardi and her girlfriend. Oh, I just, you know, they came in and they went right to the Avery family, the Avery clan, and got in with them. And obviously, you know, and I talk about this all the time, Kathy Boudin from the Weather Underground, I hope I'm getting that right. I believe she was a professor, if she's not still a professor at Columbia. They have a whole history of really aligning themselves ideologically with the wrongful conviction movement. And you could say they were groomed in that university to see the system as corrupt and Avery as the little guy. But my feeling is the little person is Teresa Halbach. And strangely, Ken Kratz and the state. Because compared to, I mean, if you look at what Making a Murderer had and Steve and Avery has as far as a legal team, even when he was, even before the documentary, he had hired, because of his lawsuit from his first conviction, overturned conviction for the essay of Penny Bernstein, he had some money. So he had really, really good lawyers defending him. I mean, they make it look like he's like just a working class everyman, but not at that time. Not at that time, he had real resources and real money. And the sad thing is that Brendan Dassey was sacrificed. The whole family said, no, you can't make a deal with the prosecutors. You have to do what's right for your uncle, Stephen Avery.
Other side of the fence during the initial prosecution, and you were Stephen Avery's original defense attorney. How would you have handled this differently?
Well, I would have filed different motions, of course. I've been asked before what I would have done if I was Stephen Avery's lawyer, and I always had the same question. I would have lost. This proved all of the...
I would have lost. I have interviewed Ken Kratz twice. You can look for those interviews on this channel. And I found him to be one of the smartest people I've ever come across. He just, when I think of Ken Kratz, I think of his intelligence. Just speaking, I mean, he spoke, I hardly had to edit him at all. He just spoke in these like paragraphs, like grammatically correct paragraphs. And so fluently and beautifully expressed, I thought, and just very, very intelligent. And I would be interesting to see him as a defense attorney. I would hire him as a defense attorney if he were still practicing, for sure.
Defense theories about planting, in our case, even before they really raised it.
So then why isn't Mr. Avery's blood on any of the objects in the car that he would have grasped with his hands, which would have also resulted in him leaving fingerprints?
Well, fingerprints are a little bit more difficult. Fingerprints are not an exact thing. In other words, there are many times, and our fingerprint expert testified, Mike Riddle testified in the trial, mostly to elimination of prints. You're not going to find fingerprints that prevalently in an area where there's lots of fingerprints. And so no fingerprint match could be made. But all the other DNA matches were made.
So then why was Mr. Avery's blood not present on the key to the RAV4 for the drive?
This is the kind of questioning I hate. It's like a child's, well, like, what if? Did you ever do that as a kid? Like, what if I get hit by a bus tomorrow, teacher, and I can't do this presentation? What if, or why didn't this happen? Because things happen the way they happen, and it doesn't make, they don't happen for a perfect prosecution case. And they don't always happen the way we think they're going to happen. Oftentimes we think that there's going to be a ton of DNA on something, and it's not. Also, we're not privy to how the criminal did things. And a confession is always, even Dassey's confession, isn't going to be complete. It's going to have him minimizing things, leaving things out, and maybe even protecting his uncle to a certain degree. So you just don't know. We just don't know. We weren't there. We don't know. And so, because, you know, evidence of absence is not absence of evidence is not evidence of absence, right? I think I just almost said that backwards.
Driver's door handle, the rear passenger door handle, the steering wheel, and the gear shift.
Well, as I indicated, I think it happens later in time. You need to know when Stephen Avery was bleeding. He was bleeding after he had parked the RAV4. So there are only a couple places that he would have reached in. By the way, my theory is he reached in across from the passenger door over towards the ignition to unlatch the hood in order to get under that.
All right, Ken, can you explain why the prosecution contended that the RAV4 could not have been driven onto the Avery property?
There's all this evidence in this case, and we'll go through it piece by piece in another episode. But blood evidence, sweat DNA, things that would be really hard to plant. But Kathleen Zellner, who has a long history representing Ryan Ferguson, getting him out of prison on a technicality, on a really weak, in my opinion, weak Brady claim, and then declaring him innocent all over media while his co-defendant sits in prison. He just got out. She has an idea that this was Stephen Avery's brother, and he was shaving, and the police were hiding in the bushes. I think she may have a new theory, because these innocence fraud campaigns, they're hard to keep up with. As soon as you think you are familiar with the new theory that's come out, they have another theory. And the old theory that you just learned is totally obsolete and forgotten, like it never existed. So the last I heard, it was Stephen Avery's brother shaving, and the law enforcement cut himself shaving, taking Avery's, like watching Avery's blood and planning it. But it was really Bobby Dassey who did it. So Stephen Avery's shaving and he cuts himself, and law enforcement's like hiding in the bushes, ready to get the blood and plan it. Just outrageous and hard to believe. But there are people who will argue that till they're blue in the face. It's amazing.
Property from the Rendant pit, despite at least four entry points from the pit.
The suggestion that this vehicle was placed somewhere and just dumped can't be true at all. There were attempts made to camouflage, to hide the vehicle. Now think about this a second. If you want to hide a vehicle, you don't want it to be found. If you want to plant a vehicle, it has to be found. You wouldn't plant something in an area which you could never probably find it. If you camouflage something, it's inconsistent with planting. Just like the bullet in the garage, Attorney Zellner's bullshit claim about that bullet being planted just avoids any kind of common sense. How would you have got that bullet in there? Did you plant it hoping someday that Brendan Dassey would say that there was gunshots in the garage and that might be found someday? Remember, the bullet wasn't found until after Brendan made his statements. The same thing as the hood latch DNA.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
All right, that is it. That is it. It's very, very short, but it gives us a little teaser, a little idea of what's going on. But I have something else for you. Yeah, it's really funny when he mentions that. I love how he calls it her BS, Kathleen Zellner's BS theory. It's really funny. Like, these theories don't work all together, and they don't have to work all together. What I mean is, you don't have to have a cohesive theory that's all that works. And this is true in pretty much every case that I've talked about, whether it's the West Memphis Three or Julius Jones or the Central Park Five. It doesn't really have to work. Like, for example, Mateus Reyes's confession, I encourage everyone to listen to it, makes no sense if you really are familiar with the evidence. Like, he talks about the thing that sticks out in my mind now, just off the top of my head, is the evidence where he talks about, I got a big stick, and he's like mentioning like this giant stick. It's like, and he's like, it just is this huge stick, which just doesn't makes no sense for the wounds that Tricia Maylay incurred. It doesn't have to make sense. It only has to make sense at the moment. What I mean is, it only has to be probable, possible. Only has to be possible at the moment. Like, is it possible for a police officer to hide in the bushes while someone shaves and cuts themselves and then gather some blood and plan it? Is that possible? Yes. Is it probable? No. But that doesn't matter. It just has to be within the realm of possibilities. You can just have to be able to imagine it until a new theory comes along, of course. But all of these theories together don't have to relate to each other to form an innocence fraud campaign. Does that make sense? On the same case. So they can have theories that don't even sort of fit with each other. Do you get what I'm saying? I hope I'm making myself clear. All right, so this is Making a Murderer, Evidence Left Out. So that sounds so promising, doesn't it, right? This is from Nightline.
Perhaps not since the OJ trial has America been so fixated on a criminal case. The new Netflix documentary series, Making a Murderer, has millions of us dissecting and debating the bizarre story of Stephen Avery. And so tonight we're going to take you to the place where it all unfolded to meet the central players and examine the evidence the documentary left out. Here in this tiny, frozen over speck on the map, the scene of a crime that has become a national obsession.
Now to a hot trend taking over TV,
a Netflix documentary series
that has captivated the nation.
Making a Murderer explores the strange legal odyssey of Stephen Avery, who in 2007 was sentenced to life in prison without parole for the murder of a 25-year-old woman. In the 4 weeks...
For the murder of a 25-year-old woman, does she have a name? Teresa Halbach. There you go.
Since the series was released, a frenzy of binge-watching, fueling conspiracy theories and outrage, both among those who think Avery was wrongly convicted, framed even, and those who think the documentary is at best misleading.
Wake up, Netflix!
So I've come to Manitowoc County, Wisconsin.
You gotta love Nancy Grace, or you don't. She's probably the most hated woman in true crime. Maybe I'm second, I don't know. But, you know, God love Nancy Grace for sticking her neck out on this one.
Johnson.
After having absorbed 10 hours of this story, to actually be here is strange.
To see if I can wrap my head around the mystery at the heart of this saga, is Stephen Avery a killer? The documentary begins here in 2000.
I can answer that. I know the answer to that. Yes. Yes. The answer is yes. You can stop filming now.
Three. Stephen Avery had just been released from prison after serving 18 years for a rape he didn't commit.
I'm glad you're home, honey.
Exonerated by DNA evidence. But then, 2 years later, just as Avery is in the middle of a multi-million...
there's Jody, the girlfriend he horribly abused. And he has a history of that, of abusing women, also flashing. I mean, this is like not a guy you'd want babysitting your daughter or even seeing your daughter, dating your daughter, anywhere near your family.
$1 million lawsuit against the authorities who put him away. Those very same authorities charge him with murder.
I want people out there to know that I didn't do it. I'm innocent.
The once celebrated face of wrongful convictions, now accused of killing and dismembering Teresa Halbach.
So are you getting that? So are you getting why it's so important for the Making a Murderer filmmakers? This is another very embarrassing case for the Innocence Project. So they had someone wrongly convicted who gets out and immediately does an even more heinous crime. Which, by the way, his cellmates say he was plotting and planning in prison how he was going to immobilize women and then murder them in prison. I mean, this is really a dangerous guy.
A young photographer who'd come to the Avery family's scrapyard to take pictures of a vehicle he was selling. Her charred remains found near Avery's trailer.
It's hard enough, you know, going to prison for something you didn't do. Then you got to do it all over again.
The story.
You got to do it all over again. See, he's not saying, he's expecting you to infer from that he's innocent. That he's doing time all over again, just like before. Like he's innocent, just like before, right? That's what he wants you to say. But so he's saying he doesn't have to actually go through the stress of lying. He can just say, because that's true. He does have to do a long prison sentence all over again, even longer than what he did before.
The story caught the attention of two aspiring filmmakers, Moira Demos and Laura Ricciardi, who packed up and moved to Wisconsin.
We were there because we wanted to ask bigger questions about the system.
Is it guilty beyond a reasonable doubt?
See, they already had ideas about the system being so unfair. And in some ways it is unfair. I mean, it's unfair. I don't know if it's obviously favors the rich, just like every other part of society. I mean, our society is unfair, right? But they have this idea that there's some sort of shadowy stuff going on. And they were willing to edit the footage down to make the story in like their imagination.
And, you know, is the process fair? Can we trust the verdict?
They ended up devoting a decade to the project, gaining extraordinary access to the main players, from Avery, who spoke to them by phone from jail.
They wouldn't look at nobody else. They're paying all their attention to me.
I mean, I really understand why you'd want to make things as fair as possible, as fair as you can make them. But I feel like this is just a larger issue in our society of trying to make everything fair when it's not possible. And the consequence is that we make even more injustice in huger, just look at bail reform in New York City, especially for women domestic violence victims, because their perpetrators aren't even being held. They're coming right out and doing the same thing.
His family waiting on the outside.
They don't care. They'll take an innocent man and make him guilty, and that's what they're doing right now.
To Avery's defense team, who argued that their client was being railroaded, alleging...
See, you see that all the time in an innocence fraud campaign. They're trying to make an innocent man guilty, and it sounds really good. You don't have to go into any specifics and tell how it's happening. You just have to put out the idea, and maybe people will buy it.
That the local sheriffs, furious about Avery's lawsuit,
framed him.
How many times will Stephen Avery be charged in Manitowoc County with rapes he didn't commit?
The filmmakers capture key moments.
Let me tell you, this is a red letter day for the defense.
Like when Avery's attorneys discover that a vial of their client's blood.
Yeah, that didn't really turn out as planned, that vial of blood, because that's exactly how they said, oh, there was a hole in it, but that's exactly how it's done. It wasn't a hole from getting into the prosecutors or the police or whoever getting into the blood vial. It's just how it was stored. But boy, is it played up in the documentary.
Evidence from his first wrongful conviction appears to have been tampered with.
Some officer went into that file, took a sample of Stephen Avery's blood and planted it in the RAV4.
Also in the film, we see that the lawyers believe the police planted something else, the key to Teresa Halbach's Toyota.
When you came into that bedroom the first time, there was no key on the floor, was there?
That's correct.
It wasn't discovered until the seventh search of Avery's bedroom. And it just so happened to have been found by two members of the local sheriff's department who had recently been.
Has anyone ever found something where they looked before? If so, maybe the man of the Wisconsin PD may have planted it. I mean, that's just what, like one of those what if, what, how come, why come questions that drives me crazy. How come the evidence was like this? How come they didn't find it sooner? Well, they didn't. Sometimes human beings are fallible.
Deposed in Avery's civil lawsuit.
Sitting here today, all these years later, do you still believe that the department or members of the department framed Stephen Avery?
I'm still left with real reasons to suspect that.
Making a murderer has transformed Avery's former defense attorney, the eloquent and emotional Dean Strang, into a sort of digital age folk hero.
Redemption will have to wait, as it so often does in human affairs.
We met him in his office where he said the case still troubles him 9 years later.
I want him out of prison and really am sort of haunted by the concern that he's sitting there innocent.
In stark opposition to Strang, some on the internet have identified.
Do people get that Dean Strang has to do that? That he's still has to say that his client is innocent? Has to. That's his job. Do people get that? That maybe that what he's saying he doesn't really believe?
A villain, the man who put Avery away, prosecutor Ken Kratz. When we arrived at his office, he showed us nasty emails.
I hope your daughter gets raped and murdered.
And threatening voicemails.
I'm going to do everything in my power to free Steve Avery, and then I'm coming after you.
Kratz.
These are the same kind of people who will come down on you so hard if you say one bad word about their pet killer, as evidenced by the free Luke Mitchell people. They will howl and laugh about a convict committing suicide in prison and har-har and threaten people. People, no, I'm not specifically saying to anyone on that side, and really harass people who don't agree with them. But say one bad thing about their, you know, pet killer, then they're a child, then they're a disturbed child like Luke Mitchell. Same with Damien Echols, a sensitive soul. Both of these two were rumored to have killed a dog, too, killing animals. Echols collected skulls, started fires, had many of the signs stalked children in the neighborhood, according to witness statements. And Avery, I mean, his whole history, that Dassey claims that Avery abused him.
Blames the filmmakers.
This is not a documentary at all. It's still a defense advocacy piece of what they pick and choose causes only one reaction and only one conclusion, that Mr. Avery was innocent.
Kratz points out that there was a mountain of evidence against Avery, Halbach's remains and her car, both found on his property. and Avery's DNA found on that key, which Kratz says was only discovered on the seventh search because that's when it fell out of the back of this bookshelf. Kratz also points out that the jury rejected the framing defense.
We, the jury, find the defendant, Stephen A. Avery, guilty of first-degree intentional homicide.
In part because they saw vital pieces of evidence the documentarians excluded, including that Stephen Avery's DNA from sweat was also found on the hood latch of Teresa Halbach's RAV4.
Why is that important? Because you can't plant, first of all, sweat. How do you leave that out of the documentary?
If his hand was there, why didn't you find fingerprints?
Well, they're looking for DNA. That's what was looked for, and that's what they found.
So you're saying they didn't look for fingerprints?
I don't know.
I would imagine this would be a pretty important thing to know. You're alleging that he drove this vehicle and hit it. I would imagine his fingerprints would be all over the thing.
They might have.
Right. That keyword is imagine. I would imagine they would be. But reality and imagination are two different things. And this is really a question for the investigators, not Ken Kratz, who tried this case. I think at this point, over a decade ago? But okay. Yeah, it's got to be a decade and a half ago, probably, when they... Long time. So, yeah, he's not going to remember every single part of it. And it is a key part. So it's a deflection. So no one has to answer how they planted sweat there. And that will never be answered. And then, of course, Avery supporters will say, well, there's no such thing as sweat DNA, right?
I don't have the case file.
According to Kratz, perhaps the most...
Meaning it's just DNA, like what we were talking about with Amanda Knox, where her DNA was found mixed with Meredith Kircher's DNA, and it lit up under luminol, meaning that the source was blood. This obviously, the most important fact is that it belonged to Stephen Avery. And he was the one, obviously, to hide the car there. It had to be either him or someone in his family. That's why all the alternative suspects are someone in his family to hide the car on his property, right?
Most damning omission in the series, Avery made three calls to Halbach the day she went missing and also requested her by name to come photograph the van he was selling.
Stephen Avery did not just come upon Teresa Halbach by accident. He targeted her.
If, as you say, Avery was targeting Teresa Halbach, why would he call and specifically request her? Wouldn't that just be a trail right back to him?
He believed, at least my theory is, that using a different name and a different phone number was good enough.
But that would require...
Right. He hid his phone number using, what is it, star 67, I think, something like that?
Require him to be pretty stupid.
Okay.
We ran Kratz's complaints.
Yeah, Avery's IQ is not high. Not high at all. In fact, very low. Have you seen the letters from Stephen Avery from prison? The guy is not a Rhodes Scholar.
By the filmmakers.
His argument is that you left out some key things. And that in the end, it was pro-Stephen Avery misrepresentation.
I disagree with Ken Kratz. It would be impossible for us to.
Yeah, just miraculously, every person who saw Making a Murderer went away with the impression that Stephen Avery was framed for Teresa Halbach's murder. Ditto Brendan Dassey. That just happened by coincidence. It was a totally even-handed piece of media. Oh, how stupid are we?
Include all of the evidence that was presented at trial. That's called a trial. What we made was a documentary. Kratz himself later said that he presented a circumstantial forensic science case, and that's what we tried to show.
A circumstantial forensic case. That's what DNA is. It's circumstantial evidence. Yeah, exactly. It was an extremely strong case. But that's hilarious that they say they didn't have time. We just didn't have time to put any of the really, really important evidence against Stephen Avery and Brendan Dassey in the 10 episodes that we had. So, yeah, I really look forward to this convicting a murder. I think it should be interesting. See what they did. Obviously, my understanding is that the first version of it had Ken Kratz really as the, I guess, the subject of the piece. And now, of course, Candace Owens is going to be edited into it, and it's going to be made to look like Candace Owens is investigating the case. So it should be interesting. I'd like to see it. This is, of course, Sean Reich, who directed A Murder in the Park, about the Anthony Porter All-Story Simon debacle. So he certainly has a innocence fraud theme going on with his documentaries.
Show in the documentary. He did not have direct evidence of Stephen Avery's guilt. I'm sure if he did, he would have used it.
Sometimes lost in the uproar over the Avery case, that he was not the only one convicted for the murder of Teresa Halbach. His 16-year-old nephew was also sent to prison, in part because of what he told police.
Who shot her in the head?
He did.
Why didn't you tell us that?
Because I couldn't think of it.
But was this admission coerced? The controversial confession up next. And the surprising twist that landed the winning prosecutor back in the headline.
Serial sexter.
Plus, our investigation leads us down that dead-end road.
That's an Avery family member.
Probably.
When Nightline returns.
Okay. I think this is a good time to take a quick break and let me rest my voice, and I'll be back on the other side of the break. If you are enjoying this episode of My True Crime Report, please hit the thumbs up, subscribe to the channel, and share this episode. Get access to exclusive podcasts and other bonus content by becoming a patron today. If you have a question or comment for me, shoot me a super chat and I'll do my best to answer it and read it on air. Thanks so much. Now back to the show. Okay, so let us get into the second part of Making a Murderer, What Evidence Left Out by Nightline.
Be honest. You went back into that room.
Don't let us down, Brendan.
We know you were back there.
I'm curious how many people in my audience have read his entire confession. Very different, right? Very different than what you see in Making a Murderer.
For some viewers of the Netflix documentary series Making a Murderer, this is the most infuriating part of the story.
Brandon, were you there when this happened?
No.
Was she dead there then or not?
Yeah.
How do you know that?
Brendan Dassey, Stephen Avery's then 16-year-old nephew, admitting he helped his uncle kill Teresa Halbach.
Tell me where he shot her.
Like in the head and in the belly and stomach.
Critics say this video shows Dassey, who has a low IQ, being manipulated into giving a false confession.
Looking at the interrogation tape of Brendan Dassey, what leaps out to you?
Cognitively impaired, naive young man led by intelligent, well-trained adults who's a manipulative set of techniques to try to get him to reveal details or adopt a storyline suggested to him.
Yeah, shame on the Wisconsin PD for not just asking Brendan Dassey, do you know anything about it? No. Oh, okay. See you later. No problem. Yeah, they wanted to, shame on them for doing their jobs and trying to solve a murder. It's a murder investigation. What do they think? But of course, they're going to try to say it was coerced because it's the strongest piece of evidence against Brendan Dassey. So of course, it has to be, something has to be wrong with it. if you're right. I mean, you're a defense attorney.
You're going to be at school before school ends?
Probably not.
But the judge ruled that the confession was given freely and willingly, and so it was allowed into evidence during Dassey's trial.
You feel confident that what we're seeing is a legitimate confession?
Yes. I would invite any of your viewers to read the entire transcript and before, again, buying what is spoon-fed them.
Even though during his trial, Brendan said he made it all up, he was sentenced to life in prison.
We, the jury, find the defendant, Brendan R. Dassey, guilty.
Well, he said he made it all up, inspired by an incredibly long book, Kiss the Girls, right, that he read. And that was hard to believe because he's not much of a reader, or he wasn't up until that point. So, yeah, no, the jury didn't buy it, nor did the judge buy that that was coerced. Anyone who's seen the whole, right, the entire confession, not just kind of edited confession, that does, the edited confession does make it look like it might be coerced, but you have to look at the entire thing, not just a piece of information. And that is really an innocence fraud technique, is, like I said before, cutting the evidence into smaller pieces so you don't look at the totality of the evidence. So if another possibility looks probable or possible, then that evidence goes out the window. But it's the totality, they generally all work together. It's a totality of the evidence, right?
A first degree intentional homicide as party to a crime.
While so many people across the country are obsessed with this story.
How many times have you been here?
Three. This is my third.
This woman has taken it to the next level.
They're okay letting you rummage through the file?
Yeah, you have to make an appointment first.
Local reporter and journalism professor Jessica McBride.
Okay, so there's a change of venue. That's interesting.
Has become a sort of freelance gumshoe.
There's so much, you know, more that didn't get through the funnel of the documentary.
Combing through the court documents herself.
Wow, you don't see her advocating for Stephen Avery now, or I haven't. Let me know if you've seen her advocate for Stephen Avery or Brendan Dassey recently. But see, she's teaching journalism students with what I would guess is the same kind of ideology, that there's something inherently corrupt or wrong with our legal system. Now, our legal system isn't perfect. Nothing is. But I wouldn't call it systematically, you know, corrupt or unfair. But that is the predominant worldview that is taught in our higher institutions.
She drove us around Mishicot, Wisconsin.
The closer you get to, say, Mishicot, in the area where the Averys actually live, the more likely people are to say, well, we're just certain they're guilty.
People did not.
What do you mean? You mean the more the people know the Avery clan, the more they think they're guilty? Isn't that crazy? The more they're familiar with the criminal Avery clan, the more they think they're guilty. Shocking. So I think, like, what you're supposed to take away from that is that the townspeople are so bigoted and hate the Averys for no reason at all. But another side of it would be to say that these people have lived with the Averys, have seen their criminality up close, and are turned off by it. That's another way to put it.
Not want to speak to us on camera about this case. And they feel really sorry for Teresa Halbach's family, who now have to live through this story yet again.
The real victim here is almost forgotten in the media hype.
A sentiment we heard echoed when we visited
Thank you, Sheriff Herman.
Manitowoc County Sheriff Robert Herman.
Here we are a decade later. You have no concern that some of your people might have done something inappropriate with the evidence?
No. I do not.
Zero.
Zero.
In fact, the sheriff revealed to us that one of the deputies who found Teresa Halbach's key in Stephen Avery's bedroom, then Patrol Sergeant Colburn, now has a new position.
He handles our evidence here and our investigative division.
Here's how former Avery defense attorney Dean Strang responded when we told him what we'd heard.
You know.
But perhaps the strangest twist in this
See, that was a cue for him to say, oh, I can't believe it. And that was for everyone at home to go, oh, those small town idiots don't know what they're doing, putting that guy in position. Because we've already seen him, his edited testimony in Making a Murderer. He's already been presented to us as a villain. And they put this villain in charge of evidence? How outrageous. And then they wanted Dean Strang to kind of give a quote that would put an exclamation point on that point. But he was like, I'm not even going to go there. I'm not going to defame that guy. Forget it. Yeah, I'm just going to say something vague. I'm not going to commit to that.
This whole saga is that 3 years after the trial, prosecutor Ken Kratz became embroiled in scandal.
Serial sexter? A third woman comes forward to say that Wisconsin district attorney sent her inappropriate messages.
He pleaded no contest to six counts of misconduct after the Associated Press unearthed racy texts Kratz had sent to a domestic.
For those in the back, did you hear he pled no contest? Took his punishment, right? And went into to rehab and resigned. I mean, that's the difference between Avery and Eccles and Luke Mitchell and all Amanda Knox and there's no honesty. There's no admission. It's just one lie after the next, in my opinion. But now, you know, Ken Kratz has to be, this is a really awful part of his history. I think he would agree.
Violence abuse victim.
I hope to regain the trust of the crime victims community.
He says his problems stemmed from a drug dependency.
Being the center of attention for 18 months every day, kind of being in the limelight and things, then going back to normal. And I started medicating.
He lost his wife and his job, but now...
That was a really interesting part of the interview that I really never got the answers that I was looking for. I was asking Ken Kratz what I was interested in knowing is, how do you deal with the come down? And obviously the answer is not well. So not only are you getting a lot of attention from the press, but trying a case like this is incredibly intense and your adrenaline is very high and you don't get a lot of sleep. And it's a kind of go, 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 go. You're very, very stimulated. And when it ends, it can be a really depressing letdown, come down. But I encourage everybody to listen to those interviews with Ken Kratz. I don't think he really went into any kind of detail with that. And that was, I know at least one of my questions, one of the two interviews I did with Ken Kratz.
Now, 5 years later, he says he is sober and running a business as a defense attorney, although he says his business has now dried up because of the bad publicity from Making a Murderer.
If this costs me my private law practice, I'll take that trade because I know I did the right thing.
Kratz may be embattled, but prominent.
I mean, Ken Kratz describes in his book people traveling to his law firm office from different states, one guy to take his fingerprints from the doorknob because he thought he was the real murderer. Other people are convinced that Teresa Halbach isn't even dead. I mean, it goes far out in this case, the kind of crazy things that people believe around this story. And it's really your basic essay and murder case. Really horrific. But is it a kind of edge of your seat whodunit? No.
Prominent voices are beginning to come to his side, including the HLN host Nancy Grace.
Stephen Avery is the killer. The evidence showing his guilt, the overwhelming evidence showing his guilt, is left out of the Netflix documentary.
But Stephen Avery and Brendan Dassey are fighting back hard. Avery now has a new attorney who has a history of freeing the wrongly convicted. Meanwhile, Dassey is waiting on a decision from a federal judge, which...
You know, they say that with no skepticism at all. So once your conviction is overturned, even if it's overturned on the most ridiculous, in my opinion, technicality, like in Ryan Ferguson's case, it's still going to be treated like an exoneration by our press. It's amazing.
Which could allow a new trial. It's easy to walk away from the documentary thinking Avery and Dassey may not have done it.
I mean, I had a good life until all the trouble started.
But the more time I spent on the ground here in Wisconsin with people like Jessica McBride.
Till all the trouble started. Like it was nothing I did. Like the trouble just started on itself. And that lawsuit, you know, that lawsuit would have been paid by insurance. It would, you know, and you're not going to get, you can ask for whatever you want in a lawsuit. Doesn't mean you're going to get $35 billion. Anyway.
Bride.
Well, should we go to the high school where Brendan went to school?
The more I realize that whatever conclusion you land on, you really have to get comfortable with some very uncomfortable facts. For example, if he did it.
You have to swallow the fact that everything was going right in his life, and yet he, at this moment when he was about to successfully sue law enforcement, was going to do something that would bring the full weight of law enforcement down upon him.
I agree with that. So what the documentary did is it focused on the inconvenient facts that are weird for the law enforcement authorities. And I think they're legitimate questions.
In the end.
Of course you think it's legitimate questions because you've probably been groomed yourself to be very anti-police by our higher education. And you continue to probably teach your students the same thing. That our law enforcement is corrupt and untrustworthy, and so is our legal system systematically corrupt, and that prosecutors don't care about prosecuting the quote-unquote innocent.
And I left Wisconsin more confused than when I arrived.
Does any part of you suspect that he may in fact be guilty?
A big part of me worries that he might be guilty. And an even bigger part of me says, you know, if convicting people on maybes or possiblys was how the system worked, that's great. We could all slap each other on the back and go out for a beer. But that's not how the system's supposed to work.
In the end, Avery's former defense attorney and even the makers of Making a Murderer say this case may remain a mystery.
Wait, so the defense attorney and the makers of Making a Murderer say it's going to remain a mystery? So that's the takeaway for the audience? That this is an iffy case? This isn't a maybe he did it case? Even though two juries, one convicted Avery, one convicted Dassey, and every appeals court has turned them down? Actually, I think Dassey may have gotten somewhere where it looked like it might look like, and then it, I think maybe another court went the other way. Forgive me if I'm wrong on that. He may have had one appeals court go his way once. I'm sorry. I will get up to speed on this case once again. But yeah, it's unreal that they're going to leave it with that. That's the takeaway, guys. He's more confused. So all the time he spent with Ken Kratz, all the time he spent with the sheriff, you know, that's not didn't convince him at all. Unreal. Unreal. Let's take a little break. If you are enjoying this episode of My True Crime Report, please hit the thumbs up, subscribe to the channel, and share this episode. Get access to exclusive podcasts and other bonus content by becoming a patron today. If you have a question or comment for me, shoot me a super chat and I'll do my best to answer it and read it on air. Thanks so much. Now back to the show. So that's just amazing, amazing, amazing. I just can't get over that. Like, I just left more confused. I'm still confused. And as I've said before, I once had a teacher who said, confusion is when you have an answer you don't want. And I would say the same thing there. I mean, this is just not an iffy borderline case. At least that's the way I see it. And we'll take it piece by piece, going through the evidence, the transcripts, the court documents, and I'll see you back next time. Tomorrow I'll be talking about, probably around 3-4 o'clock, I'll be talking about Luke Mitchell, the Scottish Damien Eccles, that's what I call him. And also in my Patreon, there's a excellent episode on Natalia Grace Barnett, the little person that the Barnett family adopted, thinking she was a 6-year-old girl, turned out to be what they say was a very disturbed adult. That episode was a lot of fun to make, and it is in my Patreon with a lot of other excellent bonus content. So please subscribe, share this episode, give it a thumbs up. Have a fantastic rest of the day and a very good week. And I'll see you back here next time.